the London, when all of them are defined, and that's what I'm not, I don't really agree that it's a good thing. But anyway, I'll do that. Let me just say, I'm going to take a picture today. Yeah, really, I'll be on the back, but it's not a good thing. So,
even Montana has pointed out to me several times, our distributions, if you look at the predicted effects of the impact are broader than we expected, but they're not that broad, in the sense that if you have a bunch of structure clustered up in wretched space around the lens, that's not necessarily down to the lens, that is really the structure that contributes significantly to the analysis. Sure. You're averaging over pretty long beams here, and I guess I wondered, and I don't know if that effect could be washed out by this kind of analysis. Have you considered using photometric redshift or something to at least limit the systems that are being counted here to those that might have the most effect on the lens?
This is certainly something that I have considered. The problem with the particular example that comes up with the single band, if we can't do that. I want to point out that the effect is that we see that very bright level, so we're not going to the faintest galaxies, which are, you know, you could assume are pretty far in the background. So I would say that this is a magnitude range that we're scoring, so naturally we reduce maybe the redshift range that we're interested in for the effect on the lenses. We're certainly just something to do. Some of the grand fields have multiple bands. And the problem with a lot of the other things is that they do not have that A14. The high band, whatever it is, the band that you use, either sonar or something else. So it's hard to come up with a good example that also runs enough to do this. So that's certainly something that we need to look into. And that's really what we're looking for.
We can take it something to a little more detail and say, so given spinal polymer, what is the cooling machine rate? This is a cooling machine rate, cooling machine rate as a function of redshift now. My breathing is gone. At the position, but in that position, it's gone. And what happens when this halo of a given mass turn off? When does it turn off this population? It's the position of the model. Locally, at redshift flow, it happens around the end of the crossover elastic, which is alpha. But as we go back in time, what ends up is group size of they turn off at about redshift 1. And the point polymer size turn off around redshift 2 or redshift 3. So this is the position of the model where you can test these simple functions. You can go on a little bit high redshift and ask what is your redshift and look at what kinds of galaxies are even in those, and then have a those kinds of systems. You take a picture actually of this model, if you see it. The very mass is a function of redshift for
No, then this is basically the mass history of what ends up in the center and so on. So the picture is that when you run a halo, that's the picture supposed to the center. You don't actually form a hot halo living in this regime. As Dessel and Parish have recently shown, there's a mass you get to in your real history. But once you get to massive enough for the gas to shock heat to form a hot halo. But this is around 2011. So you evolve, you reach the point you start to form a hot halo. Okay? So the second critical mass here, which is what we put in the model, in the simple model. Once you reach the second critical model, the quenching turns on. The low luminosity of the AGM turns on. And then you're about to halo mass, you're in the exhaustion phase, you're in the exhaustion system. So you basically actively start forming until you start to form a hot halo, then the quenching turns on until you get to the next quenching phase. That's the picture. How do you test that? That's what we're going to know. So before I say that, let me just emphasize, why does this healing work when it didn't work in the past? Or when other healing switches didn't work? And the reason is that, unlike other healing mechanisms, for example, superwind, starburst, supernova feedback driven suppression of star formation, this AGM heating suppresses star formation without itself requiring star formation. This turns out to be very important, and in hindsight, kind of obvious. That in the past, people used these strong supernova driven winds to go to that sound to suppress star formation to get the turnover in the velocity function. And they were chasing their tails because if it's supernova wind high enough, they need a lot of star formation to suppress star formation. So you need a mechanism that itself doesn't require star formation. And unlike, say, merge driven quasar wind, when it turns off the star formation, it needs to keep it off. So quasar could have a relationship one in a big system and blow the gas out and make it down to there. But you have to keep that gas out, and we live in a hierarchical universe that continues to grow. The gas will come back here and then cool. So this is the idea of a low luminosity AGM. So how do you test this picture? Well, there's a number of ways. You can look at radio luminosity functions of volumetric heating rates. The models predict volumetric heating rates. You can go and try and measure the observation. You can measure the constant of low luminosity AGM as a function of gradient, the morphology of the galaxies in their environment, for example. Or you can measure the evolution of the quasar luminosity function. And the reason why this works is if you can pick out an L-star population of quasars, and if you believe that quasars shine because of mergers, where cold gas is driven onto the surface of a black hole. But if you believe that, then when the quenching mechanism kicks in, you no longer have cold gas anymore. So at that point, you shouldn't expect to see quasars. But the mean is the quasar luminosity function should track this man at which you'll be quenching. So you can actually go to the 2QZ quasar redshift survey and measure this, including the sound exactly this. But in their quasars, their 30,000 quasars is a function of redshift, this is an L-star dominated sample. And measures the clustering of those quasars. And assuming it's recorded cosmology, it says mass, the halo. And the final possible constant is measured. So this is very encouraging because this is exactly what the model is requiring in order to produce the global distribution and the deposits. Of course, we want to be better than that. And I guess this is my connection to Lenzen. Yeah, we really want to directly measure the halo mass, but not just in terms of cosmology. So that comes out of that possible future project for people who are working with it. So the conclusion could have been, let's find that stuff working. Low luminosity AGM, we use a simple body model, it makes a prediction, it gives us a picture for what works, how this should proceed, and then we can go and test this. And it turns out that a model that accumulates is independent of star formation, this is what appears to work. And you really need observations. Understand this in more detail. And I can get a chance to put this. What I also want to say before I finish is that if you know anyone, galaxy and headed catalogs are now online. So if you had a need for 25 million galaxies at any redshift, it's full formation histories and so on. So you've got this metadata, star formation, colors, luminosity, galaxies, whatever you want. It's available to be downloaded to the FBI interface, and it's there to catch a great chunk. So thanks, man.
So we just heard from Tim Kay that you can see galaxies on the fundamental plane and presumably the red sequence via majors and possibly fine mergers, but we didn't get a chance to talk about that. And you're saying you can do the same thing via AGM feedback. Yeah. And I guess I'm wondering if the two of you have some consensus about...
No, it's a totally different thing. Tim Kay is more cosmological. So she just smashed galaxies together. She set it up and looked at the red. If you do this in a cosmological setting, what happens is that the dark matter halo continues to evolve and grow. And that's about potential shift even. And that's more variable thing. But in a cosmological setting, you require some kind of suppression mechanism. You have to have it because we live in a hierarchical universe and it's global. But you just set up the galaxy smash together and look at the red. But you need something to keep the gas out.
Okay, I'm not sure about the course there. I'm not sure that I necessarily understand that that's necessarily solved. But my question is more that, just generally speaking, even in the semi-analyzed models in the past, a lot of the emphasis has been on mergers.
Mm-hmm.
And now there's a certain shift of emphasis towards these feedback models being important in explaining the number and properties of galaxies on the red sequence and on the plane, like on maturation, all that. And I just guess I'm asking generally whether or not your feeling, her feeling, is what the relative importance is of mergers among these class of objects versus feedback as